द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ टी डी एस एंड टी सी एस विच इज इन पेज नंबर 23, टी डी एस वर्सेस टी सी एस. सो वेन इट इज अप्लीकेबल, सो वी हैव टी डी एस एंड टी सी एस पेज नंबर 23, दैट्स इट 5. सो टी डी एस एंड टी सी एस इज अप्लीकेबल इन केस वेन द सप्लाईज आर मेड टू नोटिफाइड रिसिपियंट्स आर द सप्लाईज आर मेड टू एन ई कॉमर्स ऑपरेटर. सो फर्स्ट we are trying to understand it together so that if there are any differential points also we can easily remember. So TDS is applicable whenever supplies are made to a notified recipient as per section 51 of CGST Act, whereas TCS is applicable whenever supplies are made through an e-commerce operator, so as per section 52 TCS is applicable. Now who are the notified recipients? The notified recipients are central government, state government, local authority, union territory, and then government agency, public sector undertaking, and government body where the investment of the government is greater than or equals to 51%, greater than or equals to 51%. Whenever you are making supply of goods or services to them, then whenever they make the remittances to us, so on that they will be deducting TDS. And TCS, here very important point is a supplier should be different from e-commerce operator. So when I have to make supplies through my own e-commerce platform, this concept of TCS will not be applicable. And this e-commerce operator should not be a payment gateway. So the e-commerce operator should be, you know, obligating, like they should be having an obligation to deliver the goods. Then only it will be called as supplies through e-commerce operator. For example, we have the payment gateways like Paytm, Instamozo, Razorpay, all these people. So they will not be called as e-commerce operator. So whenever they are transferring the money to us, because they will be collecting money from the buyer and they will be remitting it to us, settlement will be done. On that there is no TCS, okay? Thank God there is no TCS on that. Otherwise, no huge amount will be cut by them. And who is liable to deduct and at what rate? So TCS will be at the rate of 1%, whereas TDS is 2%. Okay, so notified recipient 2%, e-commerce operator will pay 1%. So TDS, notified recipient, will be deducting 2% and remitting the balance to the supplier, and the 2% will be paid to the government on behalf of the supplier, and the supplier will be able to take that in their electronic cash ledger and adjust with the liability. Whereas TCS, whatever is payable by the e-commerce operator at the rate of 1%, and that 1% they will remit to the government, and the supplier will be able to take that into their electronic cash ledger and adjust with their liability. And non-applicability, so this 2% and 1% is computed on what? In case of TDS, the 2% will be computed on the remittance, that is with respect to a particular invoice, how much is the remittance that is being made. So on that TDS will be computed. Whereas TCS will be computed on the value of the supplies made through the e-commerce operator minus sales returns, if any. So on that TCS will be computed, that comes in the next one. And non-applicability, that's a very, very important area. So TDS concept is not applicable in some cases. Supplier is unregistered. Sir, when supplier is unregistered, how the recipient can deduct and remit in the supplier's name? So not possible. So TDS is not applicable. And supplies are exempted or non-taxable. So the main logic of TCS is that whatever money that is being collected at the person who is making the payment, that is notified recipient, so that government is aware of what is the value of the supplies. But when they are required to aware of, when they are required to be knowing as to what is the value of supply, only when it is taxable. So when there is no GST on that goods, so what is the need of knowing about whether TCS is applicable or not? So whether what is the value of that supplies. So due to that reason, when the supplies are exempted or non-taxable, TDS is not applicable. So TCS is also not applicable. If you see, these two points are same. Supplier is unregistered. So these two points are same. And supplies are exempted or non-taxable. So two points are same. For TDS and TCS, it is the same. Whereas number 3, so it is applicable for TDS. Contract value of supply does not exceed 2,50,000. Means we entered into contract. So we should see what is the value of total supplies under that contract. The value of total supplies under that contract is 2,50,000 rupees or more than 2,50,000 rupees. Then only whenever they make the payment, TDS will be applicable. Suppose if the value of supplies under the contract, so this total contract, whatever is the value of supplies, suppose if it is does not exceed 2,50,000, less than or equals to 2,50,000, there won't be any TDS. But this threshold limit is not there in TCS. And then supplies between notified recipients, That is, whatever notified recipients that we have seen, central government, department, local authority, union territory, public sector undertaking, government agency, government body. So between them, if there is any transaction, then also TDS is not applicable. And recipient liable to pay GST under RCM, because the burden to pay GST is on recipient only, na? So then also TDS is not applicable. And finally, location of recipient and place of supply not in the same state. For example, place of supply is in Tamil Nadu, location of supplier also Tamil Nadu, intrastate supply. So therefore it will be CGST, SGST. But the recipient is located in a different state. So how the recipient located in a different state, remit 1% towards the TDS to SGST account. So that is practically not possible. Let's take a scenario. So service in relation to immovable property, location of immovable property is the place of supply. So government of Andhra Pradesh is having a building in Tamil Nadu. They identify one supplier in Tamil Nadu to provide the repair and maintenance service in relation to the building of AP government, which is in Tamil Nadu. So that supplier in Tamil Nadu provides the services to recipient, that is AP government department in Tamil Nadu. So for that supplier, the location of supplier is Tamil Nadu. Place of supply is also Tamil Nadu, because the building is located in Tamil Nadu. So it's an intrastate supply, chargeable to CGST, SGST. Now in Andhra Pradesh, so who is in Andhra Pradesh? The recipient is in Andhra Pradesh. How the government of Andhra Pradesh can deduct 1% towards SGST of Tamil Nadu and pay? Practically not possible. So in that case, TDS itself is not applicable. That is this last point. Location of recipient and place of supply are not in the same state. Okay. Then, so these are the six cases of non-applicability, and these six cases we need to remember. So because there may be some questions coined around this. And then, in case of TCS non-applicability, first two points are same. That is, what if the supplier is unregistered, TCS not applicable, and suppose if the goods are exempted or, you know, non-taxable, then also TCS is not applicable. Then we have one more case, 9 subsection 5 notified services. There are three notified services, HAT, housekeeping service, accommodation service, transportation of passengers by radio, taxi, motor cab, maxi cab, motorcycle. In that case also TCS is not applicable. Why TCS is not applicable? Because these are the notified services where liability to pay GST is on e-commerce operator only. When the liability to pay GST is on e-commerce operator only, from where they will be able to pay? So they cannot, like, so they cannot pay TCS also. So only when they pay it out of the money that is receivable, so then supplier we need to locate. But why we need to locate supplier in this case? Let them only pay GST in case of these three notified service, so TCS is not applicable. And payment is not collected by e-commerce operator. This is another point. Only when e-commerce operator collect the payment, TCS is payable. So we cannot expect the e-commerce operator to pay TCS out of their own pocket. So whenever they will be collecting from the recipient, so whatever money that is collected from the recipient, out of that they will pay TCS, and balance amount after deducting their commission will be remitted to the supplier. Okay. So therefore, if the payment is not collected by e-commerce operator, the payment is directly collected by the supplier, in that case also TCS concept is not applicable. Okay. Then next, what should be taken as the percentage? So here 2%, here 1%, interstate 2%, intrastate 1%, CGST 1%, SGST. Here 0.5% CGST, 0.5% SGST. Should be computed on what? TDS should be computed on value of supply excluding GST. That is, whatever is the remittance that is payable. Okay. So that should be taken. And TDS shall be payable to government, and statement in GSTR 7. So a TDS deductor is required to, you know, file GSTR 7 by 10th of the month following every month. Here there is one important point that you need to know. Suppose if the contract value is somewhere 3 lakhs, but that 3 lakhs is supply is made over a period of 4 months. Now in the first month, they received a supply worth 1 lakh rupees. So now in this case, 1 lakh when the government is remitting, whether TDS should be computed on 1 lakh or on 3 lakhs. TDS will be computed on 1 lakh only, not on 3 lakhs. And so 1 lakh does not exceed 2,50,000, therefore there is no TDS. No, wrong. We should see the total value of supply under the contract. The total value of supply under the contract is 3 lakhs, which is more than 2,50,000. So definitely TDS is applicable. But TDS is not computed at a time on the contract. So what is the first invoice? So for that first invoice, whatever is the payment that is made, so on that only TDS will be computed. Understood or not? Whereas TCS is very simple. TCS is computed on a monthly basis. So in that month, whatever is the supplies through the e-commerce operator minus sales returns through the e-commerce operator, on that only that 1% will be computed. Okay. So see this. So TDS, value of supply, and TDS shall be payable, and whatever TDS that is being deducted and remitted needs to be reported in GSTR7, and they need to pay that to government by 10th of the month following every month. So return also to be filed by 10th of the month following every month, even remittance also along with the return. There is something called as TDS certificate. So previously it was there, even now also it is there, but previously there was a time limit. So within 5 days from the date of deposit of TDS, it should be given. But now there is no such requirement of 5 days. The time limit has been omitted. So it is only GSTR 7A TDS certificate needs to be given. But the time limit is now omitted. Okay. So you can remove that within 5 days from the date of deposit of TDS. But actually, this effect is not done in your study material. Okay. But actually, this error is there in the study material. It should have been removed. Okay. But that will not be tested. So don't worry about it. Whereas this TCS, if you take, so whatever is the returns, that should be deducted, and they need to file a TCS return in GSTR 8 by 10th of the month following every month. So same time limit. And what about TCS certificate? We don't have TCS certificate concept. We have only TDS certificate concept. And then TDS, so if there is, you know, any delay in giving the return, filing the return, then for that delay, 100 rupees per day for every day, subject to a maximum of 5000 rupees under each act. So that will be the late fee. So this late fee is just like normal late fee for filing return, and the same late fee is applicable even for TCS return also. So for TDS return as well as TCS return, the late fee will be 100 rupees per day, subject to a maximum of 5000 rupees under each act, CGST act and SGST act. Whereas annual return, so TDS deductor is not required to file any annual return, but TCS deductor, yes, they need to file an annual return. And what is that annual return? GSTR 9B. And what if that 9B is not filed on time? What is it, the time it should be filed? So by 31st December of the succeeding financial year, it should be filed. What if it is not filed? 100 rupees per day for every day delay, subject to maximum 0.25% of the turnover. Okay. That will be the late fee in case of annual return. And interest, sir, if there is any delay in filing return, definitely there will be delay in payment of TDS and TCS. So in that case, we need to pay interest at the rate of 18% per annum from the first date after due date till the date of payment. Okay. So from the first date after due date till the date of payment, what is the due date? 10th. So from 11th onwards, it should be calculated. And general penalty up to 25,000. For non-compliance of any provisions, and for TDS, TCS default, deducted but not remitted and not deducted, then even we have 122 subsection 1 penalty. What is that? That is 10,000 rupees or TDS or TCS involved, whichever is higher. 122 subsection 1 penalty is also applicable in this case. So these are the consequences or compliances to be followed in case of TDS, TCS. And this much information, if you remember, related to TDS and TCS, that is sufficient. And so look into this as to how practically the TCS will work. First, there are three parties into this. So that is supplier, e-commerce operator and buyer. First of all, TCS is applicable only in case of supplies through e-commerce operator. So there are three parties: supplier, e-commerce operator and the buyer. So now supplies are made through e-commerce operator to the buyer. Okay. Now in this case, what is happening? First, there is a contract between the supplier and the e-commerce operator as per the contract. So supplier entered into contract with e-commerce operator to sell the mobile. So wherein e-commerce operator should sell the mobile, and e-commerce operator Flipkart will get a commission of 1000 rupees inclusive of GSTR plus GST plus GST at the rate of 18%. Now, second, a customer will place the order with the e-commerce operator, and the e-commerce operator will get the goods along with the invoice. So MI, that is supplier, will generate an invoice for rupees 10,000 plus GST 28%, 2,800 rupees. Now what Flipkart will do? Flipkart will make delivery of the mobile and collect 12,800. How 12,800, 10,000 plus 2,800, 12,800 rupees will be collected by e-commerce operator. Out of this 12,800 rupees, so e-commerce operator will be remitting how much? See, 12,800 minus, so they have commission 1000 rupees plus GST, so 1180 will be reduced, and then TCS. TCS will be computed on what? TCS will be computed on the value excluding GST. What is the value here? 10,000. So on this 10,000 only TCS will be computed at the rate of 1%. So 10,000 into 1%, 100 rupees minus 100. So 11,520 will be remitted. That is 12,800 money collected from the recipient minus 1,180 their commission and minus 100 rupees TCS deducted. So 11,520 will be given to the supplier. Now, so e-commerce operator, what is their liability to government? First, they need to pay GST on their commission. What is the GST on their commission? 18% of 1,180 rupees they need to pay. Plus, at the same way, so they need to pay even TCS. So 10,000 into 1%, 100 rupees they need to pay TCS. So therefore, 180 rupees plus 100 rupees. So these two can be taken as credit by the supplier and adjusted with the liability. This 180 rupees will be taken as, you know, input tax credit. This 100 rupees will be taken as credit in the cash ledger, okay? And that will be adjusted with their liability. What is their liability? 2,800. So in that 2,800, this 100 and 180 will be reduced and remaining amount will be payable to government, okay? So this is how the concept of TCS will work, okay?